On May 3, 1965, an 8-pound, 10-ounce baby girl named Regina was born. About 3 months later, on July 20th, she was placed in the home of Angela and Anthony Lombardo. That baby girl was then renamed Lorraine Joan Lombardo and formally adopted on June 13th, 1965. That little baby girl was my mom.
Baby, now that I found you, I won't let you go. I built my world around you, I need you so, baby.
My mom and uncle were both adopted as children, and neither of them ever knew who their birth parents were. My mom always wondered about her biological parents, but because she had such a strong relationship with her adoptive parents, she never really was interested in finding out who they were. When she was 18 years old, she decided to ask the adoption agency for what they called a non-identifying informational letter about her biological parents. This letter had information about their lives, ethnicity, ages, but not their names. Although she did not find out her parents' identity, the limited information in the letter was enough for her at the time. However, when she met my dad a few years later, this all changed. After they first started dating, they realized that both of them had been adopted as kids. Not only did this bring them closer together, but it spurred on the search for both of their bio parents. After about a year of dating, they both sent letters to their adoption agencies stating that if any relatives or their parents contacted the agency about them, they wanted to be contacted. 8 years passed and they heard nothing. Then one day in July, my dad got a phone call at work. A woman was on the line and she proceeded to tell my dad that his half-brother was looking for him. The next day, my dad and his half-brother, Joe, met. The next week, our two families met and since then have grown very close. When my dad found his brother, it re-inspired my mom to keep looking for her family. At this point, the internet was not at all what it is today, and my mom was only able to do a little bit of research on it. All of this research kept leading back to a site called The Adoption Network, which had no trace of her parents or their records. Her next step was to turn to the hospital where she was born, but they would not give her paperwork because it was confidential medical information. She was not a doctor. She was extremely frustrated because she knew if she could just get those records, she may be able to find out her original last name. After speaking with other people she contacted from the adoption network, she got the name of a woman whose specialty was getting a hold of these papers. The woman was able to get a list of all the female babies born on May 3rd, 1965 at Hillcrest Hospital. My mom knew her first name was Regina because of the adoptive placement agreement forms that my grandparents had, and there she was, Regina Panaski, father listed as unknown. This is when my mother became a super sleuth. She went to the local library and got a 1965 white pages and looked up the last name Panaski. Thankfully, it was not a common name, and there were only three families listed. After eliminating one that was just a single man and another, an unmarried woman, there was only one left. The woman who lived there's name was Opal Panaski. Could this woman be her grandmother? With each step closer, my mom just wanted to know who her parents were even more. After she found out that Opal no longer lived at that home, she found the records of the change in the deed of the home where she lived. Somehow, my mom, who can barely navigate her way around town, was able to follow the Panaskis' housing records through four different homes. When she found the most recent address and phone number, she knew what she had to do. My mom was going to call Opal. She was so nervous about calling her that she could barely speak, so my dad made the call for her. As soon as he started to talk about my mom to Opal, she got extremely suspicious sounding and denied everything that he said. After she quickly ended the conversation, my dad told my mom what happened. She said it couldn't be true, he told her, but I know she's lying. I don't know how, but I can just feel it. She's your grandmother. So my mom, undeterred by Opal's negative response, began to look for Opal's daughters. Because of where they live, she knew that Opal's children must have gone to Euclid schools. Then she called the Euclid Schools Alumni Association and asked for their help. They were able to find the names of two girls, Sandra and Marianne Panaski. Sandra was the younger of the two, and because of the non-identifying informational letter from the adoption agency, my mom knew that the older of the two sisters had to be her mom. This was it. She found the name of her birth mom. It was Mary Ann Panaski. But it had been almost 35 years since she was born. What if she had gotten married or changed her name? How would she ever find her? My mom's fear was that after getting this far, she would not be able to find anything else. Sadly, this fear was coming true. There was no record anywhere of Mary Ann Panaski. After hitting a dead end with Mary Ann, she decided to try and find her father instead. She turned back to the adoption agency's non-identifying informational letter and realized that her dad had gone to a local Catholic school and had a twin brother. So, with the help of her adoptive dad, she set out on a quest. She was going to look through every yearbook she could to try and find the two twin brothers. Her and my grandpa scoured Northeastern Ohio Catholic all-boys school libraries and looked at yearbooks and found nothing but another dead end. Her and my grandpa regrouped and decided to keep looking for Mary Ann. The two of them went to the Cuyahoga County Courthouse to look through some marriage certificates. They were able to find two certificates, one for Sandra Gachensky, formerly Panaski, and one for Mary Ann Taglia, also formerly Panaski. She had found her mom, Mary Ann Taglia, married to Jim Taglia. So she began the search for Jim. But because he has such a common name, she found over 1,000 people in her search and did not know how to narrow down. Sandra, however, had an extremely uncommon name, Gerzensky. My mom found Sandra in a mentor phone book, then from my grandpa's house, called her. She told her that her name was Lorraine Lombardo, and she had reason to believe that her sister, Mary Ann, was her mother. Sandra was in total shock and could only respond with, "Uh-huh." My mom asked about Jim, and after a little while, Sandra told my mom about how they were still married and had 3 more kids now. Could it be? She had siblings? My mom wanted to know more, so Sandra told her she would go talk to Mary Ann and give my mom a call. After about an hour, my mom's phone rang, and it was Jim Taglia, her birth father. My mom said it was one of the most awkward conversations of her whole life. After she talked to Jim for a little while, he put Mary Ann on the phone. She could barely understand what she was saying because she was crying so much. After 35 years, she finally got to talk to her birth parents. The next day, they called again and told my mom that they would like to come visit. Well, actually, they already had plane tickets, but they would only come if it was okay with her. She agreed, and they arrived later that night. Their meeting was very emotional and tearful. The next day, we all went over to my grandparents' house for dinner. Most people think that it would have been awkward for my grandparents and Mary Ann and Jim, but it wasn't. They were both grateful that the other one was there. I was 4, so I don't really remember us all meeting, but my mom always said how happy I was to have an aunt, and she was even happier to have a sister. After countless visits and phone calls, our family's relationship developed, and instead of the Taglias being like a second family to us, they became part of our family. We all became one big, happy, blended family.
Can they be that close? Just let me stay for a minute.